Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. Today we are going to see how to solve combined spectral problems for structure interpretation using spectra. So those who have studied UV, IR, NMR and mass, they can go for this video because you should have a knowledge of all spectroscopy for organic interpretation, organic molecule interpretation. So if you have the knowledge of all spectroscopy like UV, IR, NMR and mass, you can go for this video. And except MSc students, it is going to be helpful for job-oriented students, those who are working in pharmaceutical industry or any industry where they have to deal with the spectra and you don't know how to interpret it, it is going to help for you. And of course, for the competitive students, if you come across with any of these spectra, then it is going to be helpful for you as well. So let's begin. So this is our very first problem where normally the molecular formula of the molecule will be mentioned to you along with the data here. So they have mentioned here MS for mass. Mass is given for the molecule 59. This is the representation M plus radical will be there. So it is a molecular ion peak. UV data, lambda max, where they calculate the lambda max in ultraviolet spectroscopy. The solvent is mentioned here and they have given you the wavelength as well as the intensity of the peak. For NMR, they have mentioned here the data that it is singlet. They are getting in 6.2 chemical shift value, broad peak. Along with that, they have mentioned you, given you IR, NMR and mass spectrum. So this is the IR spectrum. And this is looks like inverse peak here because it is plotted with respect to percentage of transmittance and wave number in per centimeter. Along with that, you have a proton NMR and toy scale, and you have a Delis scale here. Earlier they used to mention the chemical shift value on toy scale, but nowadays we are calculating the chemical shift value in Del value scale. And this is the mass spectrum where they plot the percentage of relative abundance, the intensity with respect to mass to charge ratio. And now we'll see how to solve this problem. So the molecular formula is given. So first step is you should calculate the DBE. What is that? The double bond equivalence, which tells us how much unsaturation present in our molecule. And this is a formula. You have to learn this formula: 2C plus 2 plus N minus X minus H divided by 2. Okay. So whatever is given, we will put this value. Carbon R2 here, plus 2, nitrogen 1 and minus X. X we don't have here, that is halogen, so 0. And hydrogen you have here 5. So if you put the value, you are getting DBE here 1. So basically this molecule is having 1 unsaturation. So that is clear, where the molecule should be aliphatic, it cannot be aromatic. Because for aromatic, our benzene ring is present and at least 4 unsaturation goes for aromatic ring. We have less than that, so it is aliphatic compound. That is clear. Obviously for aromatic you should have more number of carbon here. Now next, UV data is given to you. So UV says that the wavelength is mentioned here along with the intensity. So this intensity says it is a allowed transition. So if you have around 10 to the power 4 or more intensity scales, epsilon scale, which is the molar absorptivity, so it says it is a allowed transition. So basically it is a pi to pi star transition and it is called as K band, conjugative band and allowed transition. Okay. And the other data, if you have a intensity value, the epsilon value in the range of 10 to 100, that says it is a forbidden transition and the N to pi star transition. So since the two orbitals are different, so it is N to pi star transition. We also call it R band, radical band. Okay, so 220, the chemical shift, this wavelength is higher because we know R band N to pi star transition occurs at longer wavelength than the pi to pi star transition. I hope you know the UV spectroscopy so you can understand all the terms which I am telling here related to the band, transition and the intensity. So this is your IR spectrum. We should know how to interpret it. Now you can see here you are getting a 2 broad peak in the range of 3500 to 3200, and we know that if you have a primary NH2 group, that gives us a two peaks in the range of 3500 to 3200. So it is clear that we have a primary NH2 group here. And if you have a OH group, then you can say you are getting a broad one single peak, but we don't have that. We have a two peaks here, which is broad. So it says you have NH2 group present here. Another thing, we have unsaturation. One unsaturation is present. So basically IR tells you if you have any peak in the range of 1700, then you says that carbonyl is present. And you can say here, lower value of carbonyl is present here. As you can see, carbonyl 1670 around you have a peak here. Why it is less? Because you have a conjugated. Okay, so this carbonyl should be in conjugation with the NH2. Then the carbonyl frequency is less because of the conjugation, right? So for amide, basically for amide you get 1670. So if you know IR value scale, frequency scale, you should be knowing that amide gives us carbonyl stretching in the range of 1670, and the reason is conjugation. Okay, conjugation decreases the frequency of carbonyl. Usually carbonyl gives you 1715, okay, but it is less because of the conjugation. So you have a carbonyl band, usually we call it amide 1 band, because if you assume it is amide, then you get amide 2 band also, that is for NH deformation band, for bending. So in the range of 1630, okay, so this is another peak you can see along with the carbonyl is for NH banding. We call it amide 2 band for 1630. And another for NH deformation out of plane banding, you get a broad peak in the range of 700 to 600, right? So you are getting a broad peak here. So all these peaks indicate the presence of amide, right? Your carbonyl is stretching, NH2 peak is present here, and you have NH banding. So the NH banding confirms the presence of a amide group along with the carbonyl. And this around 1400 you get a peak for amide CNA stretching. All the amide gives you the CNA stretching in this range. So all the peaks are indicating for the amide functional group. So we can assume that our unknown molecule is having CONH2. So this has come from your IR spectrum. Now you have a proton NMR here, and in proton NMR if you see only one singlet peak you are getting here, and one singlet peak, the NMR data which is mentioned in the problem, they have given that 2.0 is the chemical shift value, which is singlet. That means it doesn't have any neighboring proton to couple with it. And another peak is given, that 6.2 singlet. Usually it is not singlet, singlet, but it is a very broad peak. So therefore, since this 6.2 peak we are not able to see here because it is concentration dependent, and the lifetime of this peak is very small, therefore you are getting a broad peak here. And usually for a hydrogen bonded peak, we don't see sometimes the peak in the NMR spectrum. So therefore, this also suggests the presence of NH peak, because amide NH peak absorbs in the range of 5 to 9 del value. Okay, 5 to 9 chemical shift value is for the amide, and we are getting for 6.2, it means the NH peak is present here. And this 2.0 singlet is usually when you have a CH3 group attached to a carbonyl. Okay, because usually for primary we get a range of 0.9, but it is deshielded because of the anisotropic effect of the carbonyl. Therefore, the deshielding occur, and if you have around 2.0 chemical shift value, so or between 2 to 2.5, it suggests the presence of CH3CO grouping. And this is our NH. So if you see, we are molecular formula C2H5NO, and we have already concluded that you have NH2 and CO group, and if you subtract it, only thing is CH3 is left. Therefore, we have to just put the CH3 here. So this signal we can assume that belongs to the 3H protons, right? So in that way, we can assume the structure with CH3CONH2. Now we have to prove it, but with the help of mass spectrum. So this is the mass spectrum which is given. The molecular mass, that is the mass of the molecule, is given 59, right? 59 is the mass here. And the next peak, which is called the base peak here, the highest intense peak in the mass spectrum is called the base peak. So if you subtract it, only thing is released is 15 mass, and 15 mass goes to CS3. It means this peak, which is present here, 44. And if you know the mass spectrum, CONH2 plus gives you the M by Z 44 peak for its base peak, right? So mass, we'll draw this structure, and if you calculate the mass, it is 59. And if you do the alpha cleavage first, so the molecular ion peak will form first on the hetero at molecule, right? N bonding electron will be released easily, so N bonding electron will be ionized first, and then alpha cleavage either side you can do. So we can see in the mass spectrum it is the loss of 15, so we have to release the 15 by doing the alpha cleavage. Loss of 15 will give you CONH2 plus, which is resonance is stabilized and mass is 44 if you calculate. So we have proved the structure of 44 peak, and so we can confirm that our unknown molecule is the acetamide, as it is confirmed by mass spectrum. So in this way, with the help of a spectral interpretation, you can use and you can identify the structure of the unknown molecule. I hope you understood it, and you can apply the same concept to solve this problem. And here you can see the molecular formula I have mentioned here, C8H8O. So the first step should be calculate the DBE, right? Mass is given here, the unknown molecule. If you calculate, mass is given 120. 0.0575 they have given, because HRMS, high resolution mass spectroscopy, gives you the mass till 4 decimal point. Because there may be many molecule having the same mass. Okay, so this is the characteristic of specifically for this particular molecule. UV data is given here, 3 bands, and IR, NMR, and mass spectrum are mentioned here. So same way you have to solve the problem like we have done. So if you can, you just pause the video and solve it and verify the structure later. So now molecular formula is mentioned. First we are going to calculate DBE to find out how much unsaturation is present. So 5 is coming, means the possibility is there we may have a aromatic molecule. Whenever you have more than 4, the possibility is there that your unknown molecule may be aromatic. Okay, it's not necessary, but it may be. So now first we will find out the UV data. A polar solvent is given here, and you have 3 bands here. So first is the intense band, which suggests it is for the K band, allowed transition therefore. And again you are getting another peak 1100, which is a characteristic of aromatic molecules, called benzenoid band, and the wavelength is higher, 280 nanometer for benzenoid band. The third peak is the intensity is very weak, in the range of 10 to 100. It is a forbidden transition for N to pi star transition. And the wavelength is of course highest among the three, because N to pi star transition, the energy difference is less compared to pi to pi. And therefore the wavelength is highest. As we know, the wavelength is inversely proportional to the energy. So because you have studied this, you can understand the terms. Now second comes, so we have concluded that from UV spectral interpretation that we have aromatic molecule, right? And along with the N2 pi star transition is there, so means your carbonyl may be present here. Okay, so now IR spectrum, you can find out, first of all, as you see, just find out any peak between say around 1700. So yes, you have a peak, you can see here a sharp peak which is enlarged here for carbonyl stretching peak. So yes, we have a carbonyl stretching, and if you see it is aromatic, then you should have alkene CH stretching as well as aliphatic CH stretching. Both are present here, you can see two peaks. So aliphatic and aromatic stretching are mentioned here, CH stretching. Above 3000, if you get a peak, that is for this aromatic CH stretching. And below 3000, if you get a peak, that is for aliphatic CH stretching. So both are present, it is confirmed. You have aliphatic CH in your unknown molecule as well as aromatic CH is present. And then if you have an aromatic group, then you should have aromatic C double bond C stretching. And you can see here we are getting multiple bands, as you have three C double bonds in aromatic ring. You are getting the bands in the range of 1600 to 1450. You can see here. So this is the characteristic of aromatic compound, right? And next you can see we have CH3 CH stretching here. So very sharp peak in the range of 1360 is the characteristic of CH3 CH banding. Okay. And if you have around 1400, then it says it is CH2 CH banding. But CH3 CH banding gives you the 1360 per centimeter value. So this particular sharp peak tells you the presence of CH3 group. So many information we are getting. We got the aromatic grouping here. We got the carbonyl group. We have the CH3 group. And you can see a very sharp peak in around 1260 per centimeter, which is for CCOC stretching. That means it is, you can say, C single bond O stretching, right? Usually because you have a conjugated carbonyl group. So during the resonance, this C double bond O group will get a single bond characteristic, and therefore you are getting a sigma bond here, right? C single bond O stretching. So that is for CCOC stretching, we call it. Okay, and finally, if you are having the aromatic molecule, then either it is monosubstituted or disubstituted aromatic ring, right? So we have to find out. These are the very characteristic peak. You are getting two sharp peak in the range of one is 760 and other is 690, suggest that the molecule is monosubstituted molecule, right? So this is for monosubstituted CH banding. So all the peaks are very characteristic, and if you have the knowledge of frequency in IR spectroscopy, then you can easily identify. And we got the many grouping here: aromatic, carbonyl group, CH3 group, and it is monosubstituted from IR. Next come the proton NMR. As you can see here, you have three signals here. And two signals you are having in the range of 7 to 8, which is the range for the aromatic molecule, right? So it is again confirms the aromatic proton are present, and it is in the ratio of 3:2H. How we brought, because you can see here integration scale. This integration scale tells us the number of proton under the peak, right? So if you see it is monosubstituted as per IR, then you have one peak for the 2H proton and other peak is for 3H proton. So 2H and 3H, and this area is same as this area. So it is again for the 3H protons. So you have three different type of protons, two sets, one for the aromatic, other for the aliphatic. And this is again singlet, it is not splitting, means it doesn't have any neighboring proton. And the data which is given in the problem is 2.53H singlet, right? 2.53H singlet is given, 7.73H multiplet, and 8.22H multiplet, ppm parts per million. So how we'll find out? First is CH3CO. As I told you, if you have a peak in the range of 2 to 2.5, it suggests a CH3CO grouping. Since it doesn't have any neighboring proton, so it will split as a singlet only, no splitting. For aromatic, you have monosubstituted, then two protons which with respect to this, you have AA, because these two are chemically equivalent and the rest of the three protons are chemically equivalent, so will show a separate signal. So you are getting one for 7.7. Other, this is since it is more deshielded because of the influence of the functional group which is present here, 8.2. And all are coupling with each other, therefore you are getting the multiplet here. So basically we have C6H5 here, and we have found this, if you calculate C2H3O, so if you add it, we have got the molecular formula of our problem, C8H8O. That's it, we don't have to find anything else. So you have to just put this structure grouping on this COCH3. But we have to confirm this structure with the help of mass. You can see here the data and the signals here. This peak M is for the molecular mass. So if we assume that our molecule is C6H5COCH3, then if you calculate the mass, it is 120. Always, if a heteroatom is present, you make a molecular ion peak at radical ion peak or radical cation peak at the oxygen or heteroatom. And alpha cleavage we will do here. Loss of CH3 will give you C6H5CO+, which is the base peak here. You can see the highest intense peak, which is for M-15. We have justified that peak, 105. Then the loss of CO will give you C6H5+77, which is the characteristic of aromatic compound. Okay. So if you have a peak 105 in the mass spectrum, that suggests C6H5CO. Whenever you get this 105, it is mostly this is for C6H5CO. 77 is always for C6H5. So this suggests the aromatic compound. 51, again loss of C2H2 will give you C4H3+. Again, characteristic of aromatic compound. Now other side, if you do the alpha cleavage, basically this is not the alpha cleavage. You are going to do the inductive cleavage here. So if you do the inductive cleavage, means this particular bond is giving its electron completely to this. So here C6H5 will release as a free radical and this will release as a cation, 43. So 43, if you have a knowledge of mass, is the characteristic peak of CH3CO, one of the fragmentation. There are some other which gives 43, but again one of the fragmentation which gives 43 mass is CH3CO+. So all this fragmentation indicates the structure of acetophenone, C6H5COCH3. So in this way, we have solved the second problem with the help of UV, IR, NMR and MAS. I hope you are understanding all these concepts, how to approach towards the structure of the unknown molecule. And this is going to be our last problem for this particular video. And you can solve now yourself by pausing this video. The molecular formula is given. UV says transparent above 210. NMR is giving the low field proton NMR minus 3.2 tau. So tau value is given. If you do the subtraction, 10 minus tau, so you get the del value. Since it is minus 10 plus tau value, so 13.2. And is found to be concentration dependent. So it is that concentration dependent value. Okay. So normally this range we know goes for the acidic proton. Okay. So if you have a knowledge of NMR, this suggests the acidic proton, which is concentration dependent. IR and NMR and MAS is given to you. So same, you have to approach towards the structure. So first step is, find out the unsaturation with the help of DBE. 2, it means it is aliphatic. Now UV says transparent above 210 means it is a non-conjugated system, right? 2 unsaturation, but it is non-conjugated. It's not the conjugated system. So that information we got it. Now this IR, very broad peak, is the characteristic of the carboxylic OH peak. Okay, carboxylic OH peak, hydrogen bonded. In the range of 3000 to 2500, very broad peak. So if you have a OH stretching for carboxylic, you should have a carbonyl peak as well. And you can see we are having here two carbonyl stretching peaks, right? One is 1750, other is 1720. 1750 is the range for ester carbonyl, right? Ester carbonyl. So if you know how to differentiate between ester, ketone, acid, so then you can easily identify ester carbonyl. And why it is absorbing at high, that also factors affecting the carbonyl stretching. Other is, you can see CO stretching, 1720 is given to you. So two carbonyl group are present here. You have this pattern, you can see this is for CH banding. That is for asymmetrical stretching and symmetrical stretching. You can see asymmetrical and symmetrical. Asymmetrical is more intense compared to symmetrical. So this indicates the CH banding peaks. And you have C single bond O stretching in the range of 1200. Two C single bond O sharp peak are present. So we have C single bond O as well here. So this information we got it. We have a carboxylic group present in the molecule, as well as the possibility of ester group. Now the proton NMR is given to you, and two signals here. Acidic proton are not mentioned because that is out of the scale. this is scale is till 10, 13.2. So that is separate. Here you have two singlet here, means they are not coupling with each other, right? And if you see the integration and if you find out the area here, this belongs to 4 blocks and this belongs to 3 blocks. So 3 blocks means this is 3H proton and this peak belongs to 4H protons, as we have to verify it with respect to our molecular formula. The data is given 3.73H singlet. Okay, so CH3 is present here, which is 3.7, means it is highly deshielded, must be attached to the oxygen. If you have oxygen attached to CH3, then you get a 3.7 peak. And another is you are having 2.3 for 4H singlet, means this is again for 4H. We cannot have 4H at one carbon. So it means you have one is OCH3 and other is symmetrical CH2 grouping. Symmetrical I am saying because it is symmetrical singlet, okay, it means these are not splitting each other. So this is 4H, but you are getting the singlet here, right? Because it is symmetrical, they don't couple each other. So this is another possibility. And these are chemically and magnetically equivalent, therefore there will not be any interaction. There no spin coupling, therefore is they split as a singlet. The reason is mentioned here. So we found the COOH grouping here. We found the COOCH3. This oxygen is attached to the carbonyl, okay, CH3. So you have OCH3. We have one additional carbonyl, the ester carbonyl. So COOCH3 grouping, and you have C2H4 grouping. And if you just add all these, you are getting the C5H8 4, which is our the molecular formula, right? So that's it. We have to just put these all together to find out the structure of our unknown molecule, and then we'll verify it with the help of mass spectrum. So this is a mass spectrum, and we are assuming our molecule is CO2H, CH2, CH2, COO, CH3, right? So if you see with respect to the center, it is almost symmetrical, or you can say pseudo-symmetrical. Therefore, they are not splitting each other. The mass is 132. And we are doing the same alpha cleavage here. So once you can do both side. First of all, you can ask, there are two hetero molecules, right? Actually four. So first we will form with respect to ester carbonyl. Later we will form with respect to acetic carbonyl. So all fragmentation, all possible fragmentation we have to do here. So first here, if you do the alpha cleavage, we are getting this peak, this alpha cleavage, and which is you can see a stabilized 5-membered ring. 101 is the mass, therefore it is the base peak here, okay, and because it is the stabilized carbocation. And if you see the loss, 132 minus 101, it is a loss of 31, and 31 loss goes for mass OCH3, right? So another possibility, if you make a radical cation on this carboxylic carbonyl, and you do the alpha inductive cleavage from here. Okay, so inductive cleavage means this gets a positive charge, 87. So you justify. Intensity is weak, means the cation is not much stable. Okay, and higher the stability of cation, more intense peak will be there. The other possibility, if this give its electron completely, then again it is inductive cleavage, you are getting this 45 peak for COOH plus, right? This 73 is for, if you do the this inductive cleavage, right? This inductive cleavage, then again you are getting the same 87 peak with the loss of COOCH3, 73. So in this way, you can solve alpha cleavage for both sides with respect to ester, with respect to then acid. You can do inductive cleavage and you can verify all the peaks. But with this data only, if you do justify the base peak, we can say that our unknown molecule is having the acetic and ester group with symmetrical structure. So that's it for today. I hope this video is going to be really helpful for you. All the best. Happy learning!